Are we good?
Every time I see myself, you know, it's good. Oh, is it that way? Oh, okay.
So you're not terribly comfortable watching yourself on camera?
No.
Now, is it because you're picking at your performance or because you're picking at your own face and your arms?
Actually, when I'm working, I'm always trying to find a way to, you know, to prepare myself as much as I can before. Mm-hmm. And then when you actually start to shoot the film, I don't want to look at myself from the outside. I don't want to be self-aware. I don't want to, mm-hmm. you know, judge myself. I don't want to be, I don't never go to see myself in the monitor. I don't want to, you know, it's up to the director to have the eyes, you know, the mm-hmm. outside eyes. So it's like, then I just have to dive into it and stay in. Uh-huh. And I can, you know, then I have to push away my vanity and, you know, all my own issues. And then when you see it, like when it's done, then mm-hmm. everything comes back to you. It's just, oh, was it like that? Oh, oh my God. So it's always like you have your own feeling of, about the situations and the scenes, but it's never the same as when right. you see it. So that's my way of I have to be true to the character. Then I can't, you know, let my own issues stand in the way. So uh-huh. I have to find, I'm very self-critical also. You know, I can always see things that I can work on, that I can do better. So that's my way of pushing myself always.
So is it harder at a movie like Dragon Tattoo to watch it later when there's such an intense, you know, the rape scenes are, you know, very, very intense and yeah. there's a lot of very heavy stuff. Or, you know, compared to any other movie that may not be quite so challenging, or is it the same feeling for you?
It's pretty much the same, But I think the good thing with seeing, like, the rape scenes is, like, I know that I did everything I could, you know, mm-hmm. because I really decided to, I have to go all the way. That's the only, you know, that's the only way I can approach this. That's the only way I can go into a situation like this. Mm-hmm. I have to just do it as realistic as possible and just let it go and let go of control in a way. And so when I see that scene, I feel in a way that I can relax because I know that I did everything I could. I was mm-hmm. not trying to look good or to just, you know, pose in a way. I was mm-hmm. just in there. And I don't, you know, I didn't have any idea how the scene was. So it was quite interesting to see it later on because I had no, it was like a blackout in a way.
Yeah. Well, it's harrowing for us as an audience.
Yeah.
To watch it. Yeah. It's not, it's scary.
Yeah. But I think that's good though, because, you know, I think if you saw a rape scene, if you saw somebody rape someone, you know, mm-hmm. in real life, it would be horrible. So, you know, I hate when you see films with rape scenes or, you mm-hmm. know, sexual violence when it's entertaining, when it's like right. oh, it's quite sexy, it's like oh
yeah, yeah.
So you have to do it. If you do it, like if you do it all the way, then it's have to be terrible.
Yeah.
That's the only my truth about it.
Well, Gaspar Noé's movie Irreversible,
yeah,
oh. with that 8-minute sequence, but to me the worst part of it, the most horrifying part of it, is the guy who comes and looks at it for
yeah. Yeah.
30 seconds and then just
and
leaves
then goes, yeah.
To me that's like the most as horrible as it is to see this woman
yeah.
go through that
yeah.
to see somebody actually present themselves and
yeah.
then not do anything
yeah.
is the darkest.
Yeah, and that's how, you know, ooh, that happens so much in Sweden. We have, not maybe with rape scenes, but we
right.
have so much unprovoked violence mm-hmm. and people don't do anything. That's, you know, that's probably the worst thing, that people mm-hmm. watch it and go. Somebody's, you know, almost killing somebody, you know, on the street and people mm-hmm. just stand there and they're so afraid of getting hurt or, you know, getting involved.
Right.
So they just go.
We now have a TV show. We have on our ABC News does a thing now called "What Would You Do?"
Yeah.
And they go out and they put people in these awkward positions.
Yeah.
They see a guy put something in a girl's drink at
yeah.
a bar or whatever, and then
yeah.
see whether they do anything.
Yeah.
And of course, most of the time, people don't.
Yeah.
They just, and it's not particularly good.
Yeah.
So, choosing to do this or getting involved with doing this, a big, big deal, particularly at home for you. Yes.
Yeah. My life have changed pretty much
yeah.
lately, and the downside is that I'm very famous now, that people mm-hmm. recognize me everywhere, and it can be a bit tricky because you have to plan your life much more. You have to be careful, you have to take much, much bigger responsibility for, you know, my family, for mm-hmm. my private life. And
do you have a lot of paparazzi in Sweden? or at all?
No, but they're trying to. I think that the Swedish media, they want to create some kind of paparazzi society. Mm-hmm. And I'm the main target at this moment. But lucky for me, I'm in London now most of the time. Mm-hmm. And I don't think people recognize me so immediately. They are, you know, they have to think for a couple of minutes.
Right.
Because I don't really look the way I look in the movies.
Yeah.
And then the amazing thing is that I have, you know, I'm working with people now that I really admire, that I mm-hmm. deeply respect. So it has like this wonderful side and this more freaky side, because I don't think, you know, I don't see any value in famousship, you know, being a celebrity and, mm-hmm. you know, doing all those celebrity, the whole celebrity circus. I'm not in it, and I don't want to be, you know, that's not for me. I love my work, and I think it's so important to keep some kind of distance to that mm-hmm. world, because otherwise, you know, if people know too much about me, mm-hmm. they won't see my work. They will go into a theater and see this famous person. They won't see what kind of character I'm playing and all.
Well, that's a certain kind of acting.
Yeah.
There are certainly actors who yeah. have entire careers where
yeah.
they're kind of playing themselves.
Yeah, and I don't want to do that. So for me, I my work is the most important thing, and then it's like I have to find a way to deal with the whole famous chef.
So you started this when you were 7 years old, being
yeah.
an actor. So what inspired you when you were seven to jump in? Were your parents encouraging? Was this something they thought was a really good
actually,
idea?
Actually, my mother and my stepfather, because I didn't know my father, but my stepfather, he was Icelandic, and we moved to Iceland when I was five. Mm-hmm. And they were both in this Icelandic movie called In the Shadow of the Raven. And I just, you know, I just came with them. It was no big deal. And it's like, oh, we need another kid. And,
but they were both actors.
Yeah, no, my mom was, but okay. my dad was working with horses, so he had his horses in the film.
Uh-huh.
And I totally, you know, I completely lost myself in that world. It's like, can it be like this? So from that point, I think I knew that I wanted to become an actress. It was like a new universe that opens mm-hmm. in front of me. And I just loved it. It was magic.
So do you look for things that are out of your normal life or out of your normal range, or intentionally? Is that part of the experience and the joy for you?
I think I'm obsessed with the human psyche. You know, I think it's so interesting to try to understand what's, you know, how does humankind work? You know, what can we do under extreme circumstances, and what mm-hmm. leads us to do, you know, horrible things, and, you know. Because I don't think anybody's good or evil. I think everybody has everything inside. And, you mm-hmm. know, depending on what kind of, you know, childhood you have, if you were a love child or not, or, you know, what people have done to you, mm-hmm. that will, you know, affect you, and it will make you to the person you are today. So I think that all, you know, if all the things I'm looking for over and over is always to find something that is complicated, mm-hmm. something that questions something about humanity and about life, because I think life is—it's so much, and it's not always easy and charming and fun. It's so much more. So for me, I want to make movies about life.
So did you find those in the years from the time you were seven until this? Did you find projects that were challenging?
Yeah.
Or I've
done some bad movies.
Did you do them because you were then working and having a career, or did you do them because you thought there was something that was, that might be interesting going on?
Yeah, actually one movie I made was, it's terrible. It's called Capricciosa, and I play like a belly dancer. But at, you know, actually when I read the script, this was, I thought the character was quite interesting, and mm-hmm. she was very, a bit crazy, and mm-hmm. she was much more complex. And then, you know, when I signed the contract and all that, then the director came with a new script. So actually mm-hmm. the script we shot was not the one I signed for. So mm-hmm. I felt pretty that they fooled me in a way.
They do that.
Yeah, they do that. But I think most of the, you know, most of the things I've done have been in the same kind of area and the same kind of, I think maybe not, I'm not into darkness, but right. I'm into more things with many layers.
Mm-hmm. And you've done this in theater as well. It's not
yeah.
just been film.
Yeah.
So when your career was kind of going along and everything? Did you just kind of happen, you know, with everything just happy and you were finding roles and you were just kind of moving through a very nice career and finding interesting places, and then this thing,
this bomb,
this nuclear weapon was there in front of you?
Actually, yeah, I've been working pretty hard since I was like 19.
Mm-hmm.
And I read the books, you know, a couple of years before they even decided to do a film.
Right.
And then when I read in the paper, okay, they're going to do, you know, like a movie of the girl with the dragon tattoo. And I was so angry, you know, I was like, oh, fuck, you know, because I loved Lisbeth. And I was so sure that they wouldn't even consider me. They wouldn't think of me because I thought they were going to, you know, just judge me for, you know, being too girly or too feminine or... Because I know that I can become anyone. I can change into, I can transform into, you know, whatever it takes, and I can do anything. You know, I because when I'm working, I don't have any vanity. I can be ugly. I can be fat. I can be whatever.
And, but this is an issue when you're in that film universe. I mean, in Hollywood, it's constantly.
Yeah.
You know, as soon as somebody does something that's successful, they try to put them in a very specific box.
Yeah.
And did you go through that at home? Is that kind of
not
normal
really
there?
You know, the films I made after the Millennium films is, right, is pretty far away from that. And I was in Venice with a film called Beyond, and I play like a mother with two daughters and a husband, and she's living like a normal life, and she's very a normal person with normal problems, you know.
But you must have some degree of power having done these films to actually make those decisions. Mm-hmm. But before you had that, did they see you as a belly dancer? Did they see
That was my lowest point ever.
Do you think they had some image of you that you were?
But I think I've
away?
Done a lot of dark things and more complicated. I played a lot of messed up, broken soul, you know, personalities on stage and also in the films I've made.
So you knew you wanted this.
Yeah.
But you didn't think they'd give it to you.
No. So when I met the director, Nils, I told him that I know her. I have her. Mm-hmm. I really understand if you can't see it at this point, but I want to start tomorrow. I want to change my body. I want to cut my hair. I want to do, you know, all the piercings. I want to do everything. I want to take license for motorcycle. I want to do everything, you know. So if you trust me, I know that I will have her. And he did. And so I started the next day, and, you know, for 7 months, I was in this kind of martial art, kickboxing, Thai boxing, like 4 days a week with a Serbian guy that was yelling at me, come on, you pussy, come on, give it to me, you know, you can more, don't whine. So it was really hard, and I was on a certain diet, and I did all those piercings, because you can't do them at the same point, because then your body can turn against it. So it's like I had to do two and then wait for a month, and then I could do two more. So it was, I had to plan the whole thing. So slowly, it was like she slowly grew in me, and she came by herself, pretty much.
And then it was another year of shooting after you did all this process?
Yeah.
So basically, you gave your life over for a year and a half or so?
Yeah, yeah.
So what is that like to, is it like going into a very, very small high school, or? I mean, it's a very specific thing to do for a long time.
Yeah. It's pretty weird, because after a while, I stopped thinking about that I was doing somebody else, that I was playing, you know, a person. In the third movie, I was so into it, and it was like Noomi and Lisbeth have pretty much melted together. And I remember that I just went to work, and I put on her clothes, and it was like, it became a part of my life, pretty much, because it was for such a long time.
So if somebody cut you off when you're driving in the street, was that bad for them during that time?
Yeah, I was very, I was very angry, and I was fighting with my husband, and I was fighting with my friends, and, you know, I was very, I was probably pretty hard to deal with at that point.
And you have
point.
A kid who was 3 or 4 at the time?
Five, yeah.
So you had to still give him mommy love.
Yeah.
And all that.
But that's, I think I've learned to put the character to sleep when I'm going home. You know, it's like, okay, Elizabeth, now it's time to, you have to step aside, because now I'm going to be with my son.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, I'm getting better, you know. And I, you know, when I was younger, I couldn't really separate anything. I was just, you know, I was in my character's world, like nonstop before I had my kid.
Mm-hmm.
But now I've I've learned to navigate through it and to, because it's not like I can't really let my character, you know, go right. and leave her at work and then mm-hmm. go home. She's with me all the time. And but my son is he's been with me pretty much, and you know, he was with me when I did the mohawk and when I shaved the both sides, and he was, you know, he was looking at me and he was like, "You look cool, mommy." So he knows what I'm working with, and sometimes he's asking me, you know, are you like this because of your, you know, your work? And mm-hmm. I just yeah, maybe. So he's really.
You snap at him or something? He blames the performance?
No.
He blames Elizabeth?
Yeah. This is Elizabeth's fault.
That's right. Yeah. Elizabeth's home when we have that yeah. ice cream sandwich.
Yeah.
Well, does it feel like you've grown another skill set? I mean, is that separation and that ability to disconnect something that's really new for you with this particular picture?
Which one?
The ability to turn it off. Yeah. I guess when you have to for friends or family. And
yeah, I think it's necessary, because otherwise I will I won't last, you know, because it burns you inside. If you mm-hmm. have to, it's like I have to find a way to be able to be normal in a way, and mm-hmm. to be a mom and to take care of my baby, and still do, you know, go as far as I want when I'm working, because I want to be on the edge. My, you know, I think that our work is to actually open up things that we don't really know what it is mm-hmm. and let it come out. And then it's like, it's not really possible to have total control. You have to be able to, whoa, I'm mm-hmm. not really sure if I can manage this and if I dare this. But, you know, when you feel like, oh, this is really in some kind of area and I'm not really sure where it will lead me, then mm. it's like, okay, I have to go there.
That's the pleasure.
Yeah.
And is it still the same? Is that the same thing you felt when you were 7 and 10
yeah.
and 14? That's what it is that turns you on about it?
Yeah, I think so. And it's like, I can never be good at it. I always have to start from zero. And I love that. It's like, it doesn't matter how many prizes you or how many awards, or you know, how many times you get honored. It's mm-hmm. like, it doesn't matter, because you always, every new thing you go into is like, all the things you've done before doesn't mean anything.
Mm-hmm. So when the movie ends, does it switch off at that point? Do you give it up then, or does it take you a while to get back to you?
Yeah. I can be very, it's very strange sometimes when you're done with something and like, who am I? Mm-hmm. When I was done with Lisbeth, I was, you know, I was watching this girl with a mohawk and all this stuff in my face. Mm-hmm. Who are you? You know, after this 1.5 year, who have you become? Mm-hmm. But happy for me, you know, I started to rehearse Medea. I was, you know, doing Medea on stage. So I started like
so
1 week
later. So you
went
somewhere, you went to a comedy immediately.
Yeah.
Nice little light Medea to follow up.
Yeah.
So that was, but that took you to a different place.
Yeah.
Emotionally.
Yeah.
And what's your relationship with the film after you've done your work? I mean, obviously you care, and obviously you're interested in seeing it, but do you have a strong emotional connection to the film that comes out of that work, or is it really the work for you?
It's the work. It's mostly the work. And when I'm working, I have to ignore everybody's expectations and, you know, all the things. I have to, you know, I can't think about that people are going to judge it, or, you know, I can never do anything to satisfy other people. It's like I have to give the character my soul and my life and try to create like a fictive reality that is real. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, if we can do that, then it's up to you to see it and to judge it and to, you know, mm-hmm. love it or hate it. It's that's later. So when I'm working, and that's what I love with my work. It's like a journey, and you have to just jump into it and be there. And hopefully it will be something good, but it's like, it doesn't really, that's not my goal, to do mm-hmm. things that is good or bad. I don't really see it like that.
So what, and your relationship with directors, I mean, is it really that you read a script and you see the character and you figure out the things that you can start to go with in that, and then the director is somebody who's also on the set,
yeah.
who's helping you yeah. a little bit, but is really about that thing, or do you think, okay, I really want to work with this director
yeah.
because he could handle me in a certain way, or he does certain kinds of things?
I think it's always different all the time. You know, mm-hmm. sometimes if you read a script, and maybe the script is not amazing, but you really want to work with the director, and then it's like, okay, I want to work with you. What should we do? You know, let's find something. Let's do this person in this script to something more than she is now.
Right.
So it's like it's always much more about the persons, the actors. If you know, if I read a script that is not maybe fantastic, but you know, the lead is somebody that I really want to work with, then it's like, oh, I want to work with you. So I'm coming. You know, so it's very much about the persons.
So you're being brought into Hollywood. You're being made part of the family already.
Yeah.
Besides everybody talking about awards for this particular movie, you're already making Sherlock Holmes 2. And I guess there's talk about Aliens, the prequel. For you, is that the experience of going to Hollywood? Is it the experience of working with a different set of people? Is it a different kind of machinery that you're working inside?
I don't really... It doesn't matter for me if I'm doing like a big studio production or if it's like a small independent film in, you know, whatever. I think it's, I work in the same way. And, you know, all the people I meet, I love when you feel a connection, when you can talk about, you know, what kind of movies do you want to make? Oh, wow, me too. I want to go, you know, shall we try to find something to do? And if you can share some kind of dream and, you know, some kind of... If you say, oh, this is my track, you want to come on, you know, you want to join my train?
Right.
So that's, I was here like for 4 days in the end of August, and I met a lot of people, and I had so many inspiring meetings. And so Hollywood for me is, it's a lot of hardworking, passionate, you know, people that is trying to do great movies. And,
well, like Sherlock seems like much more of a romp, for instance.
Yeah.
You would figure that the cast on that, you know, even in the intense moments are having a good time on set, but it doesn't seem like that's necessarily your method.
No, but you know, I can always, now I'm doing a lot of research on gypsies, and I'm going to the camps outside Paris, and I'm going to Transylvania to stay and to spend some time with people, you know, travelers, and I'm learning to sing and to dance, like gypsy dances, and I'm really digging into that kind of their culture. And so I think it's very much up to you and, you know, to yourself to find a way to add the things that you want to add. And and Guy Ritchie, for example, he's very open and he's very inspiring, and he's working, and he's, you know, he's very passionate, and, you know, all the things I'm coming, you know, oh, listen to this music, and he said, yeah, I love to, and then he's listening to, you know, the music I gave him, and so it's like we are all working pretty close together.
So you have a caravan instead of a trailer? Is
I have a caravan with horses and everything.
You come to set every day with the horses, riding around London. Terry Gilliam would probably do that if you were working with him.
Yeah.
And in terms of the finances of it all, I'm guessing that you're probably getting paid more for not the lead in a Guy Ritchie movie than you probably got paid for all three of these movies.
Yeah.
Is this a consideration for you? I mean, the last night we talked with an audience, and you were saying that the idea of doing a fourth one of these movies is really not on your plate, though I'm sure you could get paid an enormous amount of money for it.
Yeah.
Not a consideration, not even an interest?
No, I never want to do anything for the money. I don't, you know, money, I think that money is, you need it, because the world is the way it is, and you have to have money. But I don't want to do anything for money, because that wouldn't, you know, I don't think I could work then if I, you know, okay, I will do the fourth film because they pay me so much. So,
right.
No, that's not me. I you know, I'm rather poor and you know, doing things that I really want to do than rich and unhappy, you know.
And does being in Hollywood, that whole thing, really matter much to you? I mean, obviously you're appreciative and you find the things you want to do, but is it seductive in some way? You've learned English in the last year and a half.
Yeah.
So it gives you the opportunity to do a lot of things.
Yeah.
I guess.
I like, you know, the things I like in Hollywood and in LA is that it's so much energy here. The people I met is, you know, everything is today. It's like, okay, today, what shall we do today? And we have this script, and, you know, and then I will read it, you know, when I'm back at my hotel, you know, I will reading and, you know, watching movies the whole night long, and then we will have a meeting next day about it. And I like that it's on the go, and it's like a full train, you know, in full speed, just rushing by, and I like that. So I like the energy.
So you've made a few movies. You already got a couple movies in the can back home, yes?
I did this Beyond. It was in the Venice Festival. And then I did a film called Baby Call, and it's supposed to be released in the spring. It's a Norwegian film.
So there is, it's funny because Americans don't really see any difference between Norwegian films and Danish films and Scandinavian films and Swedish films.
Yeah.
But for you guys, it's very significant.
Yeah, it is.
You were saying that there was a film you had done that you actually won a bunch of awards for.
Yeah.
That was not popular in Sweden, but it was very popular in Denmark.
Yeah.
So the culture is that different within that?
Yeah, I think that the Swedish people, you know, they are very judgmental in a way and a bit reserved, and they keep everything to themselves. They are, they don't want to stick out. They don't want to, you know, be too loud or too much. They are pretty afraid of emotions in a way. So you're supposed to be a certain way. And if you're not in that line, then people think that you are a bit odd. Mm-hmm. So I always felt like an outsider in Sweden, and you know, the way I am is like, okay. So when I was a kid, I said, something is wrong with me. I'm the alien, you know, everybody else is playing this game or, you know, in this thing, and I don't get it. So I think that actually, like the film I did, it's called Daisy Diamond, and it's about a young mother, and she have escaped from Sweden. She's in Copenhagen in Denmark, and she's trying to find a way to live, and she has a little baby, and she wants to be an actress. So she's going to all these auditions, and after a while, she slowly, you know, loses control over her situation, and she kills the baby in the middle of the film, and then she starts to punish, or cure, or free herself, or clean herself. That depends on how you want to see it. She becomes a prostitute in the end, and so it's a really difficult film, and with many layers, but and in Denmark, you know, they loved it, and I, you know, I won all the prizes, and in Sweden they just, you know, they were so mad at me, you know, I had like a press conference, and they said, you know, how could you do this, and what purpose, and what do you mean, and I just, they were only, you know, talking about the moral aspects.
Right.
Just, it's a movie, you know, and it brings up something important. It brings, you know, of course, a woman who kills her baby, she must be, you know, so unhappy and so far out, and still she loves her baby, because I did a lot of research and I talked to, you know, people who actually worked with women who have killed their babies. So they were so happy that we brought up the subject, but in Sweden it's such a taboo, and then people just, they didn't like it.
No. And the whole idea of Swedish tortoises is not real, that's all? Because we always think of Sweden as being sexually liberated and all, you know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it is in one way, but also, I think that Sweden has a couple, you know, in a way, a double face, you know, it's the surface that Sweden wants to show the whole world, that it's like we are so sophisticated, we are so neutral, we are very diplomatic, and we are, you know, perfect country. And then we have a lot of things going on, you know, on the carpet that we don't really want to talk about.
Yeah, so there's some, like, really good films about that, though.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're now in the award season, we're wrapping up to the moment of truth. Everybody's talking about this, and there are people who are in love with you in this town who are, you know, the movie did, you know, very good business, but it didn't do monster business, and yet people were fascinated with you.
Yeah.
Is that intimidating, going into the award season and all that, or is another character you have to perform and put up with us for another 3 months?
Well, everything is quite new for me, so I don't, you know, I just take one day. Today I'm going to the Hollywood Award, and that's exciting, you know, and I know that many people that I really admire and really respect is going to be the, like Sean Penn, and, you know, I know, and there's a lot of people that are
so
going to be honored. So then it's like, oh wow, I'm you know, I will be there with them. That's just.
So will you go up and say hi to Sean Penn, or are you too shy?
Maybe I'm a bit, you know, I can be a bit shy, but I would love to say to him at one point, you know, how much I admire his work, that he's a hero for me.
What if he comes up to you and tells you the same?
I think it would pass out or something. Yeah.